even hotter. Her ice melted, and all her species crashed. So the men of science tried to cool the Earth, to reverse the damage they had sown. But instead, they froze her to the core.
How would you combat climate change? If the answer is shoot an aerosol into the sky to dim out the sun's rays, then you've probably seen Snowpiercer. Or you're Bill Gates. I've gone down a very strange rabbit hole. Welcome back to Technality. I'm your host, Jacqueline Swan, and I'm not here to terrify you per se, but I'm also not here to calm your existential dread, mainly because I'm filled with it. Anyways, Bill Gates wants to dim the sun. Or that's what the headlines say anyways.
Our arrows will blot out the sun.
Recently, an article by Forbes came across my newsfeed called Solar Geoengineering, Why Bill Gates Wants It, But These Experts Want to Stop It. And that's not a title I can pass up because it has all the hallmarks of a conspiracy theory that I will have to debunk at a Christmas family dinner. So I read the article, checked out the scientific paper, and looked into the people behind it, and it turns out Bill Gates supports researching hypothetical technology that would theoretically block out the sun's rays, or at least dim them. And that's what solar geoengineering is, which is dimming the sun's rays to slow down the progress of climate change. An example of this is a volcano exploding and blanketing the sky in ash, essentially dimming out the sun and changing the climate below. In a TED talk, Gates explained his stance on why he believes humanity should look into this technology. For Gates, he sees it as an insurance policy. If Earth ever hits that breaking point, that tipping point where humanity needs to use this technology, they have it. And it theoretically can buy humanity an extra 20 to 30 years to deal, or at the very least, cope with the effects of climate change. Personally, I'd rather not hit that tipping point, and I think Gates is on my side with this one. That's why he has a Harvard fund that he personally finances, which looks into experimental technologies to deal with climate change. It's called the Fund for Innovative Climate and Energy Research, which between 2007 and 2020, according to their site, funded 8.5 million in climate research projects. Their site mentions that they do fund geoengineering research, but they don't fund field tests. However, their site says some of the funding supports research projects of Drs. Keith and Caldera, and some support projects outside their institutions. Now, Drs. Keith and Caldera hand out the fund. They also penned a paper together called The Need for Climate Engineering Research. Dr. Keith in 2021 was also a part of the Scopex Project, a field experiment where they would release a balloon into the air over Sweden, carrying an equipment gondola that would create a perturbed air mass roughly 1 kilometer long and 100 meters in diameter. The experiment didn't happen though, because the location they chose was over indigenous territory. Their opposition canceled the launch because they didn't want chemicals sprayed in their stratosphere to measure what would happen to the environment below, which feels like a fair ask. Since then, Harvard postponed the launch until sometime in 2022, with some experts believing that a private test of this technology will never go forward. That's why some groups are calling on the government to research this hypothetical technology. However, some scientists don't even want this field of study to be explored. They hypothesize that even field testing the hypothetical technology could have devastating impacts on the environment. In 2022, 16 researchers specializing in climate sciences and environmental policy released an open letter calling for an international non-use agreement on pursuing solar geoengineering. That was a mouthful, but essentially they want people to agree that this is a science no-no, like human cloning or necromancy. And if you believe there's another science that belongs on that list, let me know. The organization they're a part of, the Solar Geoengineering Non-Use Agreement, they could use a shorter title, has about 200 scientists behind them, and that number seems to be growing. But why does this sound familiar? Why does it sound straight out of something created by the director of Parasite? Well, because it is. Bong Joon-ho's 2013 post-apocalyptic film, Snowpiercer, dares to ask the question, how would society survive on a train after the world brings about a new ice age using solar geoengineering to combat climate change? And the answer? is not very well. The film is set in 2032, 18 years after the world tried to stop climate change with stratospheric aerosol injections, which they did by launching particles into the air to form a barrier in the stratosphere. The plan backfired, though, sending Earth into a new ice age. The last of humanity lives on a train 1,001 cars long. And of course, they keep the class system because it wouldn't be a train without it. Now, while I'd love to explore the themes of Snowpiercer, a video for another time, I'd like to look at the outcome of trying to block out the sun's rays. In Snowpiercer, the calculations are so off that Earth becomes a desolate, frozen wasteland as the sky freezes over. Now, this is all science fiction, it's speculation, it's not real, it's pop culture. But if we actually attempt this technology, and it seems to be in the current conversation about how to combat climate change, what are the potential outcomes for this technology? What hypothetically could happen? What could potentially go wrong? How likely is it that we will experience a Snowpiercer-like apocalyptic event? These are the questions that keep me up at night. Of course, I'm not here to misinterpret any information, so I reached out to experts in the field, people much smarter than me, to answer some of my burning questions about this technology.
My name is Frank Biermann. I am at Utrecht University in the Netherlands, and here I am a professor of global sustainability governance. Our group has essentially three arguments. Number one, It is so far speculative technology, and we believe that there is no mechanism in global governance that can govern the deployment of solar geoengineering. There are many risks, and there are many natural scientists who believe that the variety of things that could go wrong. So if there is at some point that there would be more certainty about impacts in some parts which are higher or different from other parts, and the question is, who decides? We have to find new technologies for mitigation. We have to get out of oil, we have to get out of gas, we have to get out of coal. We believe solar engineering will not solve any problem. It will be part of the problem. It will delay climate policy. It will derail climate policy. It is dangerous, and therefore we are against. And the third point is very simple, it's not new, it's a truly risky technology. There's huge uncertainties. And in the end, we believe also that the eventual effects of this technology can never be known.
Now, at the end of this rabbit hole I've tumbled down, I'm feeling a bit conflicted. I don't think we should use this technology. Just based off of what I've read, I don't think we should test it. I've linked a lot of resources in the description below for you to check out so you can form your own opinions about this. But I keep thinking back to what Bill Gates said and what the nations of Snowpiercer felt when they were launching those missiles, specifically about the when to use it. Yes, there could be absolutely devastating consequences to even attempting this technology. But what if, like in the world of Snowpiercer, humanity needs a last-ditch effort to combat climate change? If you enjoyed this video, consider giving it a like. And if you want more content like this, please subscribe to Technality.